Welcome to the Megacast, our live daily TV, radio, and streaming show talking about all things Oakland County and the state of Michigan. I'm your host, Tyler Kieft. You can find us on stations all throughout the local area on civiccentertv.com/megacast. You'll find more information about our flagship station, Civic Center TV and 89.3 Lakes FM, our co-flagship at My Michigan TV and community television and radio stations picking up our broadcast live and live to tape all throughout Oakland County each and every day during your work week. civiccentertv.com/megacast, the place to go for all that. You'll also find us on demand, both our full shows and each individual segment. Then there's plenty of more information from around our local area on our local news page as well, including our top stories each and every morning. Today, making news at the top of the page from Peg McNichol at the Oakland Press. Scam alert! The Oakland County Sheriff's Office is issuing a warning to consumers after over a dozen complaints about threats made to local residents over the phone, claiming that they missed jury duty and owe as much as $900 either to a state or to a federal court. Per the sheriff's office, earlier versions of the similar same scam had the rate as high as $5,000 per person. While over a dozen have complained about the recent string of these scam calls, just two have actually fell for it and gone through with the payments to these actors posing as your sheriffs. As usual, the Oakland County Sheriff, Michael Bouchard, says neither his office nor any law enforcement agency, state, locally, or federally, will call you demanding money and saying that if you get a call like this, the simplest and best way to respond to it is to, quote, just hang up, end closed quote. Here's how these quacks are operating this scam, per the Oakland Press's Peg McNichol. Quote, the scammers give out a number that is supposed to be for the sheriff's office. Most likely they're spoofing the number. Instead, Bouchard said, victims are hearing a recorded message that asks them to leave a callback number for, presumably, the sheriff's. Scammers call back with specific instructions for making a deposit, either by way of Bitcoin or by using gift card registration numbers as a form of payment for the alleged fines. Here's something to note and keep you on the lookout for: real world versus scam. If you're getting some of these sort of phone calls, none of your local agencies responsible for enforcing jury duty, such as federally, the U.S. District Court of Eastern Michigan, also the U.S. District Court for Eastern District of Michigan out of Detroit, nor the Oakland County Circuit Courts will contact you by phone about your jury duty. They will only do that via the U.S. mail. So, in addition to that, another alert for you, another red flag for you to look out for in these situations is that these courts, the sheriff's office, your local police department, and more government agencies, they're never going to ask you to provide Bitcoin or gift card registration numbers as a form of payment. They're never going to do that. They're never even really going to ask for a form of payment over the phone. They're either going to want you to do that in person so they can verify and immediately deposit those funds, or they'll do it via the U.S. mail, similar to how they contact you about jury duty, about other fines, about other issues and billing, and so on and so forth. So plenty of things to look out for in these scenarios as scam artists are trying to rip your hard-earned money right out of your pocket by claiming that they are an official authority in our local area, when of course they have no affiliation with those authorities and they're taking practices into account that these authorities don't use anyway. So if you're getting these sort of phone calls, the best thing you can do is, as the sheriff said, just hang up. I'd also suggest doing a couple other things. If you're not sure if this is real or if this is a scam potentially, if you're getting one of these calls, always make up some sort of excuse to get off of the phone call. Hey, I actually have a meeting in a few minutes, but I'll call you back. I can't talk right now. I'm in the middle of a meeting. Or if you don't recognize the phone number, what I always like to do, just let it go to voicemail. If it's something important, they'll tell you why it's important, and you'll be able to deal with it later on. If you don't recognize the number, simply do not answer the phone call. But if you do answer the phone call, make an excuse, hang up, and actually find the number of the agency these people are claiming to be from, and verify with them if you actually have missed jury duty, if you actually owe a fine for missing jury duty, if what you owe on that fine is in fact going to be accepted in the form of Bitcoin payments or gift card registration numbers. Often what they'll tell you is, hey, you're being scammed. Do not call that number back. In fact, give us that number so we can report it to a local authority and open an investigation and hopefully shut down whatever sort of ragtag operation these scam artists are running. Don't fall for this. There are so many red flags you can look out for. The worst case scenario would be that you don't want to bother somebody else at an actual agency that could help you and also investigate people trying to rob you over the telephone, when instead of inconveniencing them for a few minutes by giving a phone call and trying to verify this information coming through. So this is on the rise in our local area. Just about a little over a dozen of these complaints so far have come through to the Oakland County Sheriff's Office and other authorities. But people have fallen for these scams. And so, of course, you're going to want to keep yourself aware of this. You can find more information and supporting info on this article from the Oakland Press by clicking through on our website, civiccentertv.com, on our local news page. Also making news today from the Detroit News is Kayla Rubel. As temperatures and humidity are on the rise in our local area, so are your electric bills as summer rates kick in this week for both DTE and consumers energy customers. Starting today and running through the end of September, seasonal pricing is now in effect as part of the Michigan Regulatory Commission's time of use requirements that are changing and are now going to be taking effect during this particular season. Customers are going to be charged more for using energy during what are called peak hours. That's weekdays between 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. Running AC, running your air conditioning or other heavy electrical use during those hours is actually going to cost you a bit more. Now, it's marginal in the per hour costs, but that goes based on the kilowatts that you're using per hour. So it could actually add up pretty quickly when it comes down to things. Here's how the rates are jumping. Normally, your average rate for electrical use is going to be just about 10 cents, a little bit over 10 cents. It's actually 103 thousandths of a cent. So 0.103 dollars per kilowatt hour during normal operations. But during these peak hours, 2 p.m. to 7 p.m., Monday through Friday, that rate jumps from being 0.103 cents to being 0.158 cents per hour, too. So a little bit under 16 cents per hour during those peak hours. A good point from Consumers Energy's website on the new billing techniques and how you can avoid some of these higher payments is to follow this. Quote, with this rate, when you use electricity can be just as important as how much that you use. We're encouraging customers to save money by reducing electricity during this on-peak time or shifting use to mornings, nights, and over the weekends, end closed quote. Might not be so bad for you to raise your home temperatures during the day a little bit so your AC is not kicking in as much. That can save you a few bucks while you're out and about during your day working or running around the community, picking up your kids. And of course, limiting use of your air conditioning and other major electronics to just the mornings or the evenings and not during those peak hours. Again, 2 p.m. to 7 p.m. Monday through Friday. For me, I'm working at home, so for now, I'm kind of in a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. I'm either going to be over here basically pouring a bucket of sweat over my head from 2 p.m. to 7 p.m. as I'm working here, or you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to run a few fans on occasion directly into my face during 2 p.m. to 7 p.m. to avoid some of these higher rates. Plenty of more making headlines throughout this week on our website, civiccentertv.com, on our local news page. We got one more big story on the sports side that we'll get to you in a little bit, but plenty of more programming coming up. We got a busy show on today's edition of the Megacast. Stay tuned after this break. It's our weekly mental health segment with Carrie Krawiec from the Birmingham Maple Clinic. You're watching and listening to the Megacast.
Watch Civic Center TV with our brand new live captions. To turn on live captions, go to civiccentertv.com and click Watch Live. In your web browser, click on the Options tab in the top right and find the Accessibilities tab. Then just switch on live captions to heighten your enjoyment of our local programming. Thank you so much for watching Civic Center TV.
When you have a gambling problem, you have a money problem. Don't let your gambling cause you financial hardship. If you or someone you love is struggling with gambling, we can help. Get free confidential counseling and win your life back. Learn more at michigan.gov/problemgambling.
How can you get involved with upcoming elections? West Bloomfield Township wants you to join the ranks as an election inspector. Get trained on using polling equipment, proper procedures for handling ballots, and more to keep the voting process smooth and safe. If you're interested, go to wbtownship.org for more information or call the clerk's office with the number provided on screen. This community update from Civic Center TV and 89.3 Lakes FM.
Welcome back to the Megacast, our live daily TV, radio, and streaming show talking about all things Oakland County and the state of Michigan. I'm your host, Tyler Kieft. You can always find us on demand and learn more about each and every one of our partnering stations on civiccentertv.com/megacast. We include stations from all throughout Oakland County, including your local community television and radio stations, as well as statewide outlets, including My Michigan TV and their free smartphone and smart TV apps. All that information is linked directly on our Megacast page, civiccentertv.com/megacast, where you'll find our full episodes and each individual interview segment on demand as well. Again, the website, civiccentertv.com/megacast. As we exit the month of May, which was Mental Health Awareness Month, we enter the month of June, otherwise known as Pride Month, dedicated to uplifting LGBTQ voices, celebrating their culture, and supporting their rights. Joining us now on the program to talk about the mental health of those in the LGBTQ community is Carrie Krawiec, a therapist at the Birmingham Maple Clinic. Carrie, thank you so much for joining us today.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Glad to have you on the show. And as we talk about a group like those in the LGBTQ community, much like other marginalized groups, there's a number of different mental health effects and therefore other physiological health effects that come from that, that often come along with being from a marginalized group like this. So when we're talking about the LGBTQ community in particular, what are some of the common mental health ailments that do often come along with people in these particular groups, given where they're at in society, the way that society treats people in these communities, and some of the challenges that they face in day-to-day life?
Sure. So certainly people in the LGBTQ community are more likely to experience depression and anxiety, like you said, as a part of a result of either internalized experiences of isolation and self-esteem uncertainty, whether or not they can be safe and safely themselves. And then also, like you said, related to minority stress in the sense the outside pressures that they cannot feel like they can be safely themselves and feel like there's threats to harm or hopelessness that they will be accepted and loved by either their close family or the community around them. And the research, recent census data really shows that those feelings are the highest among the youngest of the LGBTQ community. And although they maintain higher rates across the LGBTQ community instead of the straight community, they positively do get lower and lower as a person ages. So as a person becomes, feels more connected to their community, feels more pride in themselves, those feelings do tend to go down.
And that's what's so important about addressing these issues in these communities, because of course, so many of them do stem from societal issues that then affect individuals and affect groups in the LGBTQ mm-hmm. community. So from a mental health professional standpoint, where do you begin as a professional? Because for some, they're going to go to people that are in their community that are professionals in this regard, who have a better perspective on some of the trials and the tribulations that they go through in day-to-day life. But for someone that maybe is not in one of those communities and is treating these people, how would you approach these sorts of issues that they're facing that are in some ways similar to what other people are facing, but are very much unique also in some ways to their community?
Sure. So I think, right, one of the ways in which therapists and social workers and psychologists are trained is to consider context. And so now you may not know every single detail of a person's context, but to know that context exists, that different generations have had different experiences, different people in different parts of the world have had different experiences, different people from different orientations have had different experiences. Knowing that the context exists is one way in which therapists can approach approach a situation, at least with curiosity and compassion and just the understanding that context plays a role. So, you know, I think what's interesting is if you ever talk to LGBTQ adult, they have those awareness of their feelings from early childhood. And even before they experience bullying, ridicule, criticism, lack of acceptance, they do experience themselves as different because there may not be a close person in their family. You know, or young children are, you know, experience really only their siblings and their parents and maybe some other children at school. They don't necessarily have a way to place their own context, right? They don't know. They think maybe perhaps I am the only person who feels this way, as opposed to one of many, 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 many millions. And that sense can create stress and anxiety across a lifetime, right? That I'm alone in this. We've talked about that with other mental health issues, whether it's depression, anxiety, something else. People feel very alone in their feelings. Nobody feels the way that I do. Part of talking to a therapist and reaching out to other people is to learn that there is a broader context, there is a shared experience, and you are not, in fact, alone.
And it's got to be tough, too, to be in these communities and see some progress being made over the course of the last decade or so in regards to uplifting people in the LGBTQIA plus community, but also seeing some of the regressions too, especially in recent years and even in our modern times throughout our society. And that balance has to be tough to cope with too. So for individuals that have LGBTQIA plus people in their lives, what can they do to help maybe shoulder some of the load that comes with some of these issues that we're seeing continuing to pop up, the rhetoric that is out there that is often targeting people in the LGBTQIA plus community?
I think you're absolutely right. And perhaps that's part of the explanation why people in the older age populations, although they may identify in that community, do not experience the same degree of depression or anxiety as younger people, is that they have in fact lived a lifetime where they have seen the context change, where they've experienced the benefits of progress and maybe even been involved in the benefits of progress. And that in itself may help be a protective feature, right, to resilience and recovery and those kinds of things. I think perhaps also younger people, you know, teenagers, young adults are at heightened risk for depression, anxiety, eating disorders, and the starts of those things to begin. And again, don't necessarily know to feel like, right, this is something we can overcome, that we can do hard things, and that other people have done hard things before us and will continue. So I think really just staying informed, you know, learning from generations before you, just meeting with other people, getting to know them and talking about their experiences and what they've encountered can help offer resiliency to even the younger populations.
And as you mentioned, the disparities in some of these feelings, particularly of depression and anxiety among different age groups in the LGBTQIA plus community, there is some staggering data on that. In fact, from the U.S. Census Bureau's Household Pulse Survey from 2021 to 2022, that shows the level of depression by percentage in LGBTQ communities in age groups 18 to 29 is significantly higher, 53.6%, than those in non-LGBT communities, where it stands at 30%. And that trend is really staggering across all age groups, but it's particularly high in those in younger age groups. Beyond the societal elements of this, what makes those in younger populations in the LGBTQIA plus community so much more susceptible, particularly to depression, but also to anxiety, where that same level, 60.8% of those surveyed by the U.S. Census Bureau said they do have feelings of anxiety in 18 to 29-year-old age groups?
Sure. I think perhaps there's probably multiple explanations, but some that are coming to mind, if you're thinking, if you're still in school age, perhaps high school, leaving high school, maybe, you know, starting college or even starting the workforce, your life may feel out of control for many reasons. And then when you add this dimension to it, like you're out of control of perhaps knowing or not knowing, like I said, who you can safely turn to. You're out of control if you're, you know, like I said, still in you know, school, you know, high school situation, you're out of control of who you're sort of subjected to every day. So then they report higher instances of bullying, higher instances of criticism, a sense that they're not accepted and that you really can't choose your environment. That once you're later on into your adulthood, you can make choices to pick workplaces or leave workplaces or, you know, enter into certain things where you have your own, a little bit of your own volition, where the younger population doesn't. Again, like we've talked about too, just using social media and stuff, again, fostering this idea that somehow people are different and misunderstood and not as well liked for perhaps as someone else can affect someone's self-esteem. And right, those things would just be magnified if you were also carrying the stress. I think also the stress of a secret, if you're not yet out, you're carrying the pressure that perhaps you're deceiving people and at some point they are going to confront you or discover your truth. And that feels also like a burden.
And this is a time of the year too, during Pride Month, where there is so much support within the LGBTQIA plus community for others that are either out or still not out in that community. But also it's a time where that support maybe encourages people that have not been out to come out. And that can cause some issues too in families that maybe have individuals that don't understand what it is like to have this part of your identity that is so strong, that is so central to who you are and how you feel in our world, maybe be changing from what it has been during the course of that relationship. So for families in particular, and for friends as well, for really anybody, if someone is coming out, you know, what suggestions do you have for those people in terms of both being encouraging, but at the very least being respectful of someone taking what is a significant step in their life and making really a move in their life, a decision in their life that puts them in a very vulnerable spot, living their truth, living their true identity.
I love the way you said that, because I think, of course, in a family, upon hearing information, right, like you said, there could be so much gratitude. Here you've trusted me with something deeply personal. You're looking to me for my acceptance and affirmation. Like, parents and families and siblings in many ways should be honored and thrilled that they're that given this moment of, like you said, like intimacy and vulnerability and to convey that also with respect and encouragement. On the flip side, right, for some people to just even be to allow for the compassion of their other family members that they're getting information that perhaps might cause them some fear, not even if they're trying to be judgmental, but that they also would fear for their child or their sibling if they thought they were going to be mistreated in their community, if they just don't have a cultural norm or a connection to a community to be able to just feel safe themselves, that there's also a degree of coping and processing that would have to happen for those people. And, you know, to of course, our perfect situation would be this perfect moment, but to share together that a whole range of emotions would, of course, be acceptable and allowed, and can they be had without causing hurt or harm.
We're joined by Carrie Krawiec on today's edition of the Megacast, the therapist at the Birmingham Maple Clinic. You can get in contact with Carrie and all of the professionals at the Birmingham Maple Clinic at birminghammaple.com. Today we're talking about Pride Month, and in particular, helping those in the LGBTQIA plus community as they navigate still a treacherous world today. Maybe is not as treacherous as it's been in the past, but to say that it's not still a difficult world for these individuals to live in and be accepted in just simply for being who they are would be a discount to their life experience. It's so really important that we're talking about this today. And as we talk about the mental health issues that can arise as a part of the anxiety and the often vitriol that comes toward this community from rhetoric all across the board, certainly in the media, being a supportive person in people's lives in marginalized communities can be really important in maintaining their mental health and preventing some of the more severe cases of depression or anxiety. You can be that rock in their life that they go to for support in a world where often they do tend to sometimes feel closed off, especially if they're not out. So Can you give us some advice, Carrie, for those that may want to be that support system or continue to be that support system for someone in the LGBTQIA plus community? The difference between being an active listener and a support system versus maybe being intruding or, you know, providing unsolicited advice in a space that maybe you're not even familiar with yourself.
I mean, I think, yeah, that's like probably the most important thing you said right there is just being self-aware of your own limitations and doing your own work to inform yourself and, you know, what kind of education or, you know, information is available to you, and just being open to receiving it, I'm sure is certainly an important feature of any kind of growth. I think that, like you said too, I mean, there is exposure to information that is hurtful and damaging, but we probably don't realize we have as much choice as we do in what we're exposed to, that if you're encountering fearful or frightful news articles, that perhaps it's okay to modify your use, you know, to certainly, like I said, stay informed and to stay safe, but that if what you're experiencing is routinely upsetting to you, perhaps limiting your exposure to those kinds of pieces of information and diving in, I think just getting involved in other organizations and other community groups or, you know, online, there's the Trevor Project, there's GLSEN.org. There are ways in which to feel like a community of giving supportive information to help offset what we hear in the news, which may be intentionally amplified to cause distress and panic.
Yeah, and it kind of goes to the basic principles of talking with anybody about topics that may put them in a vulnerable position. Either they're being vulnerable in a sense, and when I say vulnerable, I mean in the sense of they're opening up to you about issues they're having in their life. They're opening up to you about their identity. They're opening up to you about their feelings. All of those put people in vulnerable positions and require a certain level of sensitivity. And so no matter what you're going into here, or no matter what you're discussing with somebody in your life, I think these principles, Carrie, can really be an important part of being a support system and what it means to be that support system, that rock for someone in your life. That active listening is super important. Validating people's feelings without necessarily bringing your opinions into it or even your own life experiences into it if it's not asked. Those are all part of simply hearing somebody out, because often for individuals, especially in marginalized communities, from my experience speaking with people in my life from those perspectives, mm-hmm. is it often can seem like there is a lot of noise out there, and in some cases it is a lot, it is often just noise, but they're looking for a place to voice something that's been eating at their mind. So how does that all play into just really talking to anybody about their mental health, and what can we learn from these experiences that the LGBTQIA plus community has had in speaking about their mental health?
Sure. Like you said, I mean, right, intimacy comes from taking a risk. You take a risk and you reveal something about yourself, whatever it is, if it's part of your sexual identity, if it's part of your history, if it's something you've encountered in your lifetime, if it's a dream or hope for your future. When you share that with someone else, you take a risk. You take a risk that they'll minimize it. You take a risk that they'll counteract it or try to beat it with something of their own, or that they'll judge you. And right, and then when a person does not do those things, then they make you feel safe, heard, and accepted, and maybe share something deeply personal about themselves in a generous way, then the reward, right, is that you feel closer to that person. And so when in any form of a relationship, whether it's a therapeutic relationship, a romantic relationship, a parent-child relationship, or friendship, that dynamic continues to exist, right? Is that we take a sort of a small toss of something personal of ourselves to someone else, and our hope is that they catch it safely and then toss us something back. And we get that rhythm going with deeper and deeper information. And I think, so just recognizing that, also recognizing it doesn't have to be perfect. There are fumbles along the way. Sometimes we do say the wrong thing, or, you know, make the wrong, I don't know, eyebrow raise. Some of these things are, you know, they happen very instinctively and outside of our control, right? But to be able to then take ownership for them and correct, say, hey, I noticed I made myself, like I said something judgmental and that wasn't my intention to be hurtful, but now I'm willing to talk or think more about what I said and how that impacted you. And and you just go back and forth, like I said, with these like sort of gentle tosses, almost like tossing an egg, right? You want to catch it gently and then toss it back gently. And as you get deeper and deeper with information, you feel safer and safer to do that.
Well, Carrie, we appreciate you joining us to give us some insight on talking to individuals from marginalized communities, especially as we begin Pride Month in June and try to provide as much support as we possibly can to our friends, our family, and our loved ones in the LGBTQIA plus community. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
You can join Carrie and I each and every week for our weekly mental health segment on the Megacast right here on Civic Center TV, and always find us on demand on civiccentertv.com/Megacast. We'll take a break. On the other side, we'll talk to one of the many artists you'll see this summer in July at the Ann Arbor Art Fair on over 30 blocks of downtown Ann Arbor. After the break, Matthew Rucker, a painter you'll see at this year's event, will join us on the show. Plus, news in the sports community right here in Detroit. The Pistons have a new head coach. I'll talk to you about that and give you my opinion on their latest hire after this break. Stay tuned. You're watching and listening to the Megacast.
One in four Michigan homes has high levels of radon, a naturally occurring radioactive gas known to cause lung cancer. It doesn't matter where you live or what type of home you have. You won't even know it's there unless you test. So don't wait. Testing is cheap and easy. And if there's a problem, it's simple to fix. Visit michigan.gov/radon to learn more.
We took action. Will you?
Let's savor these moments, made possible by the COVID-19 vaccine. Keep the dining out going by keeping yourself protected and your COVID-19 vaccines up to date.
I'm Steve Eisenman of the Detroit Red Wings, and I think every child in Michigan deserves a safe, healthy, and happy childhood. Can we build a state where children trust Michigan isn't just a name, but something our kids believe? Please support Children Trust Michigan as the voice for children and families by visiting the website to learn more.
Welcome back to the Megacast, our live daily TV, radio, and streaming show talking about all things Oakland County and the state of Michigan. I'm your host, Tyler Kieft. You can always find us live and on demand on civiccentertv.com/Megacast, where you'll also find links to every single one of our partnering stations and their original programming in the 23 hours of the day, Monday through Friday, that they're not with us here on our live shows from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. Joining us now on the program is one of over 1,000 artists across various disciplines that will be spread across 30 blocks of downtown Ann Arbor this July at the Ann Arbor Art Fair. Matthew Rucker is a painter you'll see at this year's show and joins us today on the Megacast. Matthew, thank you so much for being here.
Absolutely. My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, glad to have you on to talk about your art. As I mentioned, you are a painter, but your painting, as with most artists, has a very unique style that you bring to the table. So tell us about your style of painting and also how you got into this form of art.
Well, my style of painting I created, it's called hyperminimalism. It's a combination of hyperrealism and minimalism. So it was kind of a strange evolution that brought me to this current series where I'm trained as a surrealist. That's, you know, I spent my life painting like Salvador Dali, you know, a lot of weird images on a canvas. And eventually, as time went by over a few years, fewer and fewer and fewer things were appearing on my canvases. And then one day I just got down to, there was one thing left on the canvas as I was, you know, making new paintings. And then I took away the background. And then I was like, this is kind of getting into an interesting place. And I did a show. I just experimented with a show and it sold out. And I was like, okay, maybe I'm onto something. And I developed it a bit further. It's taken off in a wonderful way. And really it just comes down to my journey to being the change I want to see in the world. You know, I think the world is it's loud, it's busy, it's chaotic, and my work is is my counter to that. I'm doing everything I can to make the world a kinder, calmer, more joyous, beautiful place.
So how does that manifest in these paintings? Because as you said, hyper-minimalism, the style of painting that you do, combines realism, but also with minimalism. So you're trying to make things then, if I'm breaking this down correctly, trying to make things look very realistic, but also without having an overwhelming amount of detail. So how do you make that work to create these paintings that are hyper-minimalistic?
Well, it's a balance of a few things. Composition, of course, is huge. As you can probably see behind me, my paintings are a large area of ambient space and then a single object on the canvas. Usually that object is an animal. Sometimes I'll do something a little bit different, but the vast majority of the time, it's just a single animal. The ones you see behind me are works in progress. They're not quite finished. So like this elephant up here, other side doesn't have a shadow or anything, but that's a good example there. So the minimalism, of course, comes from just the fact that there's one item on the canvas. That's it. There's one focal point. That's all. The hyperrealism comes in when you really get close. That animal, that image is going to be painted in extraordinarily high detail, like photorealistic detail. And you know, I've always believed if you're going to only paint one thing on a canvas, you know, it's going to take a while for your eye to get to that object. You want to make it worth the journey.
And you can find more of Matthew's art, including some of the paintings you're seeing on the screen at MatthewRucker.com. Please continue, Matthew.
Oh, that's quite right. Now, every animal I paint is a portrait of somebody I love depicted as an animal. So it's not just here's an animal on a canvas. It goes a lot deeper than that. I'm focusing. It's only positivity. I only paint positive and good things. So the whole time I'm painting that animal, I'm focusing on that one individual, an element of their personality, a memory with them, things like that. And I'm actually like spending time, just one-on-one time with somebody that I care about when I'm working on that painting, and I'm putting all that energy into the painting. And I found that what an artist puts into work comes out of the work, the viewer. So that's the hope.
Joining us on the program today is Matthew Rucker, a painter out of Minneapolis, Minnesota, who you'll see this summer, July 20th through the 22nd at the Ann Arbor Art Fair, three art fairs all in one across over 30 blocks of the heart of Ann Arbor here in Lower Michigan. Matthew, on your website, again, MatthewRucker.com is the place to go to look at all of his art and to find more information. It notes down there that you are colorblind, and that's interesting too for a painter who's going into extreme detail, and a lot of times that detail involves color. Especially when you're talking about the variety of different animal life that you're putting into these paintings. So how has your color blindness had an impact on your work? And how is that all, both from your ability to create these works, but also in the outcome of these different paintings?
Well, it certainly provides a bevy of challenges, but also has some benefits. So I see about 1% of color. I see about 1% of what a person with normal color vision would see. So it's rather limited. I do see color. My wife tells me that I think I see a lot more color than I actually do. But I do see blue, red, yellow in a limited quantity. And she is my color vision when it's necessary. As you can see, like elephant and the betta fish behind me, those are just, they're black and white often. I paint black and white animals, but when something does require color, then my wife helps me when I mix my palette. So I can kind of get it right and not have a green fox. It's really actually informed my art in a lot of ways because I've had to make exceptions and changes and adjustments and ways to adapt to use my color blindness in a good way. And some of those things include like my backgrounds, for example, they're a very subtle gradation, a very subtle ombre from light to dark. And that's difficult to do. And I have, you know, 30 years practice doing that. But more than that, because I'm colorblind, my eyes see things differently than a person with normal color vision. Where my cones are deficient in seeing color, my rods overcompensate in seeing things like detail, gradation, texture, et cetera. So I can actually see the gradation much better than someone with normal color vision. So it actually assists my work in a way that someone who has normal color vision can't really do what I do because they can't see it the way I see it. And I also use very strange and interesting colors that a lot of artists wouldn't use too.
More information on Matthew's art can be found on MatthewRucker.com. You can also learn more about the Ann Arbor Art Fair, including where Matthew and other artists will be placed at the fair, by visiting TheAnnArborArtFair.com. That's TheAnnArborArtFair.com. And of course, the art fair happening this July, July 20th through the 22nd. That's a Thursday through a Saturday. Thursday and Friday, July 20th and 21st, 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. Saturday, the 22nd, 10 a.m. until 8 p.m., featuring artists from all across the U.S. and around the Midwest and around the world as well. Ann Arbor Art Fair can be found, theannarborartfair.com. Joining us today is one of the artists at this year's art fair, Matthew Rucker, a painter out of Minneapolis, Minnesota, coming into town. And you talked about the motivation behind your style of painting and the art that you're creating, but tell us about your journey to turning art into a career. Where did that begin for you?
Well, that began when I was little. My grandfather was an artist. He was a sculptor, and he saw something artistic in me very, very early, and he encouraged that a lot. And luckily, I had very supportive parents. My mother is an artist as well, musician, singer, etc. And both my parents encouraged and allowed and helped me become an artist. Sent me to art school when I was, in college. And, so I'd always been doing it. And it was when I left college that I decided I wanted to turn this into a career. This is what I need to do for a living. And years and years and years of just hard work and study and trying to, do the right things and play the right games. And eventually I got there, and I've been a full-time artist for about 20 years now. And everything is wonderful.
And as a traveling artist too, as someone that goes to art shows, both for my professional life and also just for my own personal appreciation of art, one of my favorite things about going to an art show is having these sort of communications with artists, learning their stories and understanding their motivations behind some of these pieces. This is one of the reasons that we do partner with the Ann Arbor Art Fair leading up to the art fair, and having artists on each and every week to talk about their craft and talk about what they're bringing to Ann Arbor in late July. For an artist like you, what is the most inspiring part of traveling with your art and meeting art lovers, both in your area of the world, in the Minneapolis area, and all throughout the country as well?
Well, it's just what you said. It's just getting to have great conversations with great people. I get to meet people all over the country, have fantastic conversations. I get to learn new communities, new cities. I love finding new food, new restaurants. That's a big part of the fun of traveling. But yeah, it's just really getting to meet people all over the place and have great conversations with good people, about art, about their community. Anything goes.
And you'll be at this year's Ann Arbor Art Fair, again, July 20th through the 22nd. You can find Matthew's art there. More information on the art fair at theannarborartfair.com. And preview some of Matthew's art by visiting matthewrucker.com for more information as well. And Matthew, have you been to the Ann Arbor Art Fair before? Have you showcased your art there before?
I have. I've been there since 2019.
This will then be your fourth year showing there, 2019 through this year in 2023. What about Ann Arbor makes you want to return again for another year after being there since 2019?
Well, again, it's a great community. It's a great town. It's a really fantastic art fair that's well run, well organized. It brings in a really great quality of clientele. You've got, you know, amazing people from the Ann Arbor area that come in, and then people who come in from all over the country for this show, because it's so big and such a good show. A lot of people come in from all over the place. And so fantastic conversations with people from all over the place, really good food. I love some of the restaurants out there. And it's a fun show to do and a fun town to be in.
More information on the Ann Arbor Art Fair can be found on its website, theannarborartfair.com. Friday and Saturday, it'll be, but also Thursday, July 20th, 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. That's the same time period on Friday, July 21st, Saturday, July 22nd, the final day of the Ann Arbor Art Fair, 10 a.m. until 8 p.m. It features three different art fairs, the original street art fair, the state street art fair, and the summer art fair across 30 blocks in Ann Arbor. More information on Matthew's art can be found at MatthewRucker.com. Matthew Rucker, a painter who will be at this year's Ann Arbor Art Fair once again, as he has been since 2019, joining us on today's edition of the Megacast. We've seen some of your art on your website at MatthewRucker.com throughout this interview already, but what are some of the different pieces that you're planning to feature at this year's Ann Arbor Art Fair?
Oh, I've got a bunch of new stuff coming this year. It's going to be fun. Several pieces I've done just for this show. I've got a new elephant, a new fox, new swan. Some of the, I don't want to say standard images that I do, because there are some animals that I like to paint over and over, but there's some, I've got big cats for the first time ever. I haven't shown any of those publicly before. I've got everything from small pieces, my smallest being like 11 by 14, all the way up to some really, really big ones. So it's going to be quite a variety. And I'm bringing a bunch of brand new prints this year, something for everybody, and including prints of the newest pieces that I have available. Some of the new paintings that'll, the originals will be up as well.
More information on all of Matthew's art can be found on MatthewRucker.com. And you can also see him at this year's Ann Arbor Art Fair, July 20th through the 22nd, on over 30 blocks of Ann Arbor, three different art fairs, hundreds of different kinds of art, and thousands of artists from all across Michigan, the Midwest, and around the country coming into Ann Arbor. More information and ways that you can get involved at the Ann Arbor Art Fair. .com. And of course, again, to keep up to date with all of Matthew's art, MatthewRucker.com. Just a few more minutes with you, Matthew, before we'll have to wrap things up for today. Anything else you'd like us to know about your art or about your appearance at this year's Ann Arbor Art Fair?
Oh, I'm just looking forward to the show. It's, like I said, it's a great show. And I think it's this one's going to be really fun with the new work I'll have, and getting to see the new work of all the other artists there at the art fair. Get to, you know, eat at some of my favorite restaurants, and yeah.
You can join in on all the fun along with Matthew and thousands of other artists of all different disciplines by visiting theannarborartfair.com or joining him at this year's art fair, Thursday, July 20th through Saturday, July 22nd. More information on theannarborartfair.com. Matthew, thank you so much for joining us.
Tyler, it was absolutely my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it was great to have Matthew on the show talking about his art. Every week we'll have a new Ann Arbor Art Fair artist on the program as we lead into the late July show in Ann Arbor. July 20th, it begins in Ann Arbor again. TheAnnArborArtFair.com is the place to go for more information. Finally, one more story making big news this week in the Detroit sports community on our local news page on CivicCenterTV.com, coming from Kirkland Crawford at the Detroit Free Press via other outlets. The Pistons have found their new head coach in former Phoenix Suns head coach and 2022 Coach of the Year, Monty Williams, agreeing in principle to a six-year deal worth $78.5 million late on Wednesday night. That first reported from The Athletic's Shams Charania, as well as Pistons beat writer with The Athletic, James L. Edwards III, confirming this report. That the Pistons had agreed in principle with Monty Williams, one of the most highly coveted head coaches on the market in this offseason. Of course, most recently, he has been coaching the Phoenix Suns, where in the last few seasons has had great success rebuilding that roster and that team's performance from being one of the worst, if not the worst, actually, in the conference on the western side of the NBA into a perennial contender. It helps to have guys on the roster like Kevin Durant and Chris Paul and Devin Booker, but helping them take the next step forward has been a huge part of why he was so successful in Phoenix. Getting past that hump and being able to beat the top teams in this conference in the last couple of years, and of course, trying to get over the hump and win a championship was not quite working, so he was let go by the Phoenix Suns. But you know, that's happened with many head coaches across the league of late who have had a lot of success and then been let go by their teams. In some cases, and in the case of Monty Williams in Phoenix, I would argue prematurely. Now, he turned down a big offer previously from the Pistons, per reports, but it seems like what happened here is the Pistons ownership, particularly owner Tom Gorez, was reportedly very high on hiring Monty Williams as the next head coach of the Detroit Pistons, and was willing to take a private jet, fly out to Monty Williams, talk with him directly, and offer him a gigantic contract. $78.5 million over the next 6 years is the contract that Monty Williams agreed in principle with the Detroit Pistons to become their 37th head coach. That's about $13 million a year. That doesn't include incentives, which according to The Athletic, could end up making his contract upwards of $100 million. So if the Pistons end up striking it big in the next few years, becoming a contender, maybe winning the Eastern Conference, maybe contending for or winning a championship, which would be quite lofty in my opinion, but not outside of the realm of possibility, that could mean this could be an even more lucrative contract for Monty Williams, a guy who was pointed out, I don't recall who, and I don't have it pulled up right here at the moment, on social media. It was pointed out last night, I was reading after this announcement was made, that he's making more than almost everybody on the Pistons' actual roster per year as the head coach. Unprecedented, something we haven't seen in a long time here in Detroit. They've gone out and they've gotten their guy and refused to take anything less than the absolute best on the market. Just a reference, over the last three seasons, and Richard Hamilton, of course, Pistons legend, was talking to a media outlet yesterday about this hire. Over the last three seasons, no coach has won more games at the helm than Monty Williams. 160 wins in the last three seasons, beating out Mike Budenholzer of the Milwaukee Bucks, who was also recently fired this offseason, who had 155 wins, and Doc Rivers, formerly of the Philadelphia 76ers, who was also fired recently. Three head coaches, all with the most wins in the last three seasons, all fired this offseason, including two of the last three or four championship-winning coaches. So the Pistons getting their guy, getting a really solid head coach who's, among all other things, been great in helping develop talent and build a locker room culture. So many guys in NBA circles have talked about that being the biggest impact that Monty Williams has made on them, whether it be Chris Paul, who Monty Williams recently coached in Phoenix, but also coached earlier on in Chris Paul's career when he was previously the head coach of the New Orleans Hornets at the time, now the New Orleans Pelicans. That also was a big impact for them as well. And a great story, too, if you're looking through Twitter and you look up Justin Spiro from the Spiro Avenue Show. He's a Michigan State podcaster. But he put a really great story up on his Twitter page, at Darko State News, about Monty Williams and just the impact he has on his players. A few years ago, well over a decade ago in 2011 during the lockout, something he did for one of his players who had lost a family member while players and coaches weren't allowed to interact with each other due to the lockout. That tells you a lot about his character and how he treats his players, and should have a big impact on the Pistons going forward with plenty of young talent on this roster, from Cade Cunningham coming back from injury, Jaden Ivey, Jalen Duren, and also the fifth overall pick. So good news in Detroit Pistons sports. Last night, some good news we've needed after a lot of losing seasons of late, the worst record in the NBA, and losing out on the number one pick and ending up in the worst scenario possible for them at the number five overall pick. Finally, some good news for the Detroit Pistons. That is going to do it for today's edition of the Megacast. Big thank you to everyone who joined us on the program today, including you at home. You can always find us on our website on civiccentertv.com/megacast. In addition, a huge thank you to our crew, Calvin Brown, at the studio of Civic Center TV, our director on today's edition of the program and all of our editions of the program. I'm Tyler Kieft. Until next time, take care of each other, and we'll see you very soon.